This video is the second in a series about biochar. The first spoke to numerous properties of biochar, and if you didn't see it, I'm sharing a link right here. This video will speak to the easiest way I've found to make the charcoal needed for biochar. In many ways, I've stacked the deck against ideal conditions with the batch made for this video. First, I didn't use the best tree species. Being a fan of holistic land management practices, I instead used sweet gum and willow saplings cut along the edges of a gravel road I have on my property. These wood species are not as dense as oak or hickory that I've used in the past and burn more quickly, making increased ash production a greater risk. And with biochar, you want the carbon skeleton structures of charcoal and do not want ash, which is burned to the point of losing the key pore and plate nutrient-holding structures. Nor did I let the wood weather and dry for any significant time, instead stacking it immediately after cutting it and burning it just a few weeks later. Unlike many other charcoal making videos, nor did I dig a deep cone-shaped pit or use a retort system, which requires using a smaller closed drum or vessel placed inside of a larger drum. In fact, the single drum I used has seen so much use over multiple years that the bottom is rusting out and has an irregular border, hardly ideal. But yet, using just a bit of well-placed dirt around the bottom and stacking wood in a certain way and frequency, I ended up with very little ash and relatively good quality charcoal. As I start discussing my methods, let me share. I'm blessed to live on land with most of the resources I need, such as an unlimited amount of pine lantern wood for easily starting fires, and an endless amount of branches and downed trees available for burning. The methods I use also involve a bit of sweat labor. For anyone watching without access to wood, you can still make biochar by using store-bought wood lump charcoal. A number of YouTube channels, such as Garden Like a Viking and M.I. Gardener, both cover this process well. Now for showing you how I make charcoal. So I actually begin my process with the bottom of my barrel relatively open, thus allowing oxygen to feed my initial fire from the bottom and top. I also use lantern wood from pine heartwood to get my fires going quickly and initially quite hot for the sake of kickstarting the process. For those who've never burned lantern wood, the sap in the heartwood makes it burn quite easily and quickly. After getting my fire going well, I then begin stacking wood in my barrel until it reaches the top. For large batches, it's important to understand you'll need to repeatedly add wood throughout the day. You can use this first barrel full to help calculate how much time you can wait and work on other projects between adding loads of wood to the barrel. As the fire moves upward into the wood stacked at the top of the barrel, you can prevent the wood near the bottom of the barrel from turning to ash by creating a low oxygen environment, also known as pyrolysis, both by reducing the amount of oxygen allowed to feed in at the bottom and by the wood burning at the top preventing the wood below from having as much oxygen. As the old saying goes, the proof is in the pudding, so I'll let the results shown later in the video speak to the effectiveness of my method. One key way I stop the flow of oxygen through the bottom of the barrel is simply shoveling dirt around the bottom perimeter once my fire is burning strongly. From that point forward, it's just a matter of adding wood at intervals to keep flames burning near the top of the barrel as the hot coals below are prevented from turning to ash. When gauging the time between adding wood to the barrel, I'm looking for the amount of time it takes for wood at the top to burn and settle downward, as well as the wood beginning to show signs of turning to charcoal, such as red coal coloration with just a touch of white ash production. In the case of this particular batch, I found the timing between additional loads to be approximately an hour and 45 minutes. Knowing the amount of time I had to work between needing to add wood allowed me to cut grass in several fields that I have, and I even found a white-tailed deer antler shed while doing so. Starting the burn around 10 a.m. and regularly adding wood until 6 p.m. allowed me to create approximately 25 gallons of charcoal in one day. My process for stopping my burn is to cap the barrel, thus starving the burning wood of oxygen. I found this process to be far faster and less labor intensive than spraying it with a hose, as coals take quite a bit of time to put out with water. Extremely hot coals can vaporize the water and keep it burning for quite some time. Furthermore, if water from a hose leaves even one ember burning in a pile of uncovered charcoal, you may find that your coals dry out and burn overnight, leaving you with mostly ash after a hard day's work. Capping the barrel with a lid, on the other hand, sees the temperatures drop quite quickly and dramatically. In just 10 to 15 minutes' time, a barrel exterior can go from steaming hot to obviously cooling. It also makes me feel safer using a barrel I know will prevent any chance of a fire from restarting or escaping while I sleep at night. In each case where I've used a lid to cap my barrel, by the next morning, all the resulting charcoal is completely extinguished and ready to safely handle. I repeated the exact same process as the next day, and by the end of the second day, I burned all of the wood I initially stacked and created almost 50 gallons of charcoal in the process. Worth noting at this point, larger chunks of charcoal can be saved for uses other than biochar if desired, such as using for metal forging or for grilling food, though specific tree species used may affect both temperatures for forging and taste when used in cooking. The final step I'll discuss in this video is reducing the size of charcoal before inoculating or charging it. This is truly the most labor-intensive step of any I'll discuss in any of my videos, but one that outside of time invested is free of cost with the bucket and shovel aside, and it gives me a good workout. I simply use a flat-edged shovel to chop larger charcoal pieces down to size, approximately a half inch or smaller. I'm left with quite a bit of size variation, but a mix that blends well with organic materials I add when charging it and helps increase water retention in my North Florida sandy soils. Several things worth mentioning relating to reducing the size of charcoal chunks. First, burning smaller limbs to begin with would definitely make the process a bit easier, and as I shared at the start of this video, I knowingly stacked the deck against myself by using 3 to 5 inch diameter cuttings. I also should add, I've seen other methods discussed that sound as if they would be far less labor intensive, such as using a wood chipper, placing charcoal in sacks, and driving over them repeatedly. Just being honest, I've never shied away from a good day's work, and thus far haven't minded putting in the sweat equity. That shared, by all means for those watching this video who've tried different methods to reduce charcoal size, I welcome comments sharing preferred methods. And that's it for this video. With a reminder, I hope to soon share the final two videos in the series, with one speaking to the process of charging biochar, and the final video showing ways I actually put it to use. If this is your first time watching a video on my channel, the majority of my videos center around the outdoors and trail camera captures of local wildlife. If you enjoy what you see, please feel free to subscribe, knowing I won't flood your feed, as I don't post daily and instead only upload videos when I feel I have something truly worth sharing. Thank you for watching.